That's introspective writing. One more note about this is this has to be private. You have to be able to write with complete honesty in a way where you're never worried about someone else seeing this. And you can do that by, you know, writing in notebooks and keeping those safe. You can do that by writing in encrypted files. You can also do that by the most radical version of this is to write on paper and then burn it. And in the beginning, when I was starting this practice, I had trouble being fully honest with myself. And this practice is what helped me. I would write things down and then burn it. So I could be 100% sure nobody's ever going to see this. And that is something that really helped me get to that point where I can be 100% honest with myself in writing. Because that's a prerequisite. If you're writing for an imaginary audience, then you're never going to get close enough to the truth.
Yeah. And just to sort of reiterate that, the way I think about it is there are certain emotions that we're okay feeling certain emotions, and some emotions we have a negative or critical relationship to certain emotions. Mm. And if we say, for instance, if we were taught as we grew up to never experience anger, which a lot of people are, anger is inconvenient for parents.
Yeah.
So a parent would be like, don't be angry. Heard this in like supermarkets. Like, what? Stop being angry. Kids angry. It's like, stop being angry. It's like, okay, good idea. Why didn't I think of that? You know? So it's like basically telling a child, your anger is not welcome. Your anger is not okay. So the kid ends up learning that anger is not okay. So I put anger in what I like to call it the shame closet. You know, you've got a bunch of stuff in the shame closet. And this kind of stuff doesn't go away, because it festers. Now, the reason I'm saying this is because when it comes to writing in a journal, it has to be private, because there's some emotions that you feel are so shameful that you struggle to even say them to yourself, let alone other people. You struggle to own it around other people and to yourself. So when you start writing it in a journal and you're totally private, and this encourages you to be totally honest, that's when you can start bringing some of these things out of the shame closet.
Yeah.
And they can finally stop festering, because in the shame closet, the more full your shame closet is, these kind of things, they don't go away. They just puppet your behavior from behind the scenes, but without your conscious awareness of it, these things just happen. Like, you emotionally react. Like, I had a client that used to get terrible, like demonically possessed road rage, but she was like smiley and happy every other time. It's like, right, oh boy, you got some rage in that shame closet. You know, and then I didn't work with her for that long, but if I had done, I would have sort of started to drift into the realm of, okay, who are you really angry at? Because it's not a driver. You don't even know them, you know. But so private writing allows you to be totally honest, which is so useful.
Shame closet. That's a great term. Yeah. We have all this stuff in the shame closet, and it gets worse the longer we pile stuff in there and try to avoid it, the worse it gets.
Yeah, and I'm not going to take credit for that idea. That's an idea from Brené Brown.
Nice, okay.
The shame researcher, she's fantastic. She's great, yes. That's her sort of term. It's like, you put it in the shame closet, it doesn't go anywhere. Mm. And shameful stuff, shame, it grows in the darkness.
Yeah,